And you pray that the Lord would have his way and kind of reveal to us his will. And so the Mark chapter 9, that's real close to where we were this morning. Mark chapter 9. And I'm going to start reading with verse 41. And then immediately we're going to go to Matthew chapter 18. Kind of like the way that Brother Gary put that this morning, with your copy of the Word of God, amen, follow along with us. Mark chapter 9, verse 41. For whosoever shall give you a cup of water to drink in my name, because ye belong to Christ, verily I say unto you, he shall not lose his reward. And whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me, it is better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and he were cast into the sea. And if thy hand offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands to go into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. For it is better for thee to enter halt in the life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire, where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. All right, as I promised, let's go to Matthew chapter 18 and verse 1. At the same time, or at the time came, same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Jesus called a little child and unto him and set him in the midst of them and said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same as the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. And whoso shall receive one such little child in my name receiveth me. But whoso shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck, and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. Woe unto the world because of offenses. For it must needs be that offenses will come. Amen. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. Wherefore, if thy hand or foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed rather than having 2 hands or 2 feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye rather than having 2 eyes be cast into hell. Take heed that you despise not one of these little ones, for I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven. And let us pray. Father, we look to you and thank you, God, for the sweet spirit that we've had today, Lord, this morning, this afternoon, tonight. Our fathers, we gather to worship. Lord, we read your word. Father, I pray that you might manifest it to our heart and our lives and draw us closer. Father, I pray that each one under the sound of my voice and under the influence of your spirit tonight is able to hear and to understand and to gather in your word the truth, Father. And I pray, God, it be applied to their heart, regardless how young or how old, Father, we might be tonight. Each one of us, our homes and our families could be blessed because of your word and this time that we share in your house. Father, I pray that you'll touch me, those that are not able tonight to be here. We ask your blessing and hand on them, and that you'll bless mightily, Father, these that are able to, having the desire, Father, and for the encouragement of your Spirit to come. I pray in Christ's name, for whatever's accomplished, we give you all the praise, honoring the Lord for the things that you've done, are doing, and Lord, what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Title of the message tonight, Has the Flame Gone Out? Now, I'm not talking about your flame, amen. And you've got a flame, and it needs to be burning brightly for Jesus. But that's not what I'm talking about. Has the fire of hell gone out? Two places I read to you, Mark 9, also in the book of Matthew 18, are the two renditions of what I believe the same teaching, even though it may not necessarily be the exact same time. Jesus probably taught often a number of things over and over again, depending on the congregation, the crowd, the multitude that he had. The Bible says, John tells us, if everything that Jesus did and said had been written, even the world could not contain the books. And so I believe that he taught over and over, and a lot of the truth that we hear in the Word of God may have been taught a number of times. And so I believe this is the same truth that he's teaching right here. But look at the way it's put. And he talks about in Mark chapter 9, in verse 41 through 48, he's talking about how that in verse 44, he talks about hell and the fire and the burning and the hand and the eye and the foot and all of those things. If you find them to be an offense or getting you into trouble, I cut your hand off, pluck out your eye, tear up your foot, amen, better to go into heaven with one of each of those than to have all of those and to enter into hell. Understand the teaching that's going across here. You're not better off if you go to hell with everything you got. But you're a whole lot better off if half of you goes to heaven, amen, and you make it all the way. And so that's what Jesus is trying to get across unto those that are listening. It's better to go to heaven half of a person than to go to hell with all of you. Amen. I want you to come with me now. Let's go on a story. Let's go on a walk. That's what we're talking about. And so then he goes on to say the next part of it, verse 44. This teaching is given to us over and over again, this truth. This is what he said. There, where there, T-H-E-I-R. This is a personal, possessive pronunciation that is meant to be a thing and a place. Amen. It's something that's real. T-H-E-I-R. There worm dieth not. Study that I did a long, long time ago, and what that verse meant when I was just a young preacher boy. I getting ready to preach one time. I studied on what does it mean where it says that the worm dieth not. And so I thought about that and prayed over it and come up to it. And the conclusion that I came up, I believe God showed me, that he's talking about the soul. The eternal soul that man has. The worms die, amen. The body, it dies. But your soul's eternal. And so he's talking about where you can enter into heaven complete or halfway complete. One eye, one foot, one hand, what have you. But make it all the way to heaven. He said, but if you go to hell, the Bible said their worm or soul died not. And what? The fire is not quenched. It continued. Go on, the next part. Verse 45 says pretty much the same thing, but then it gets down to the end. Verse 46, where their worm died not. Again, talking about the soul. And the fire is not quenched. And then it goes on, verse 47. Same thing with the eye. Verse 48, where their worm died not. And the fire is not quenched. Now that same teaching is given to us in Matthew chapter 18, verse 1 through 9. And then he talks about, let me just go ahead and cast it up together so we can look at it together. In verse 8, he said, wherefore thy hand or foot or offend thee, cut them off, cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life, halt or maimed, rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into what? Everlasting fire. He's talking about a destiny and eternity that's never going to end, and it's never going to end in a place that burns constantly with fire. Let me go ahead and say this is not PC correct, amen? Not politically correct. Not going to, people are going to find this as one of those, well, that made me feel good, and well, I like that, let me hear some more. No, in fact, I'm going to tell you something tonight, that the majority of the church world, from the way that I hear and I talk to folks, they don't want to hear that they're going to spend eternity somewhere that's not good. Most everybody that you talk to is willing to spend eternity somewhere that's good, someplace that's close like earth, but it's nowhere near like hell. Amen. But the Bible said there's two places to go. You either go to heaven, enter into life, or you enter into hell. You go to hell. Amen. And so you go to God's heaven or you go to hell and you spend eternity there. Heaven has no fire. It has no light. Jesus is the light of that city. And if you go to hell, there's going to be fire there, but there's not going to be any light there. Amen. The Bible said there's going to be smoke there. There's going to be torment in hell. All of these things. And so the question I had as I studied, God spoke to my mind this afternoon, has the flame gone out? People want to take the fire out of hell. They want to take the punishment out of hell. They try to doctrinize all of what hell's judgment is and make it just as comfortable, make it just as satisfactory as they can. But friend, you cannot change the eternal meaning, the truth of the Word of God. Hell is going to last forever. In fact, the Bible said death, hell, and the grave are going to be cast into the lake of fire. I've got a few things I want to share in all of that, but as I studied back in 1963, how many remembers 1963? Whenever the JFK was assassinated and he was buried where he was buried, and at the place of his graveside, where JFK's graveside is, they got a flame that they called the Eternal Flame. And 30 days after his wife lit that light, that gas light or whatever it is, a natural gas flame, 30 days after that, there were some kids from a Catholic school that came to visit the grave of Kennedy, who was a Catholic, and they were going to sprinkle a little holy water around the flame, and guess what they did? The bottle cap came off of that holy water, and it put the eternal flame out. I think that's amazing. Not necessarily hilarious, but it's funny, amen, that they were able to put the eternal fire out with a little what? Holy water. I have no clue why it was holy. I know that they say there's different things in some church, whatever, have that it's holy. I think if you're thirsty and you drink it, it's holy. Amen. Does you some good. But here it is. Sometime later, trying to search it out. There was only one other time where that eternal flame went out. I think that is the most pompous statement that can be made, that man can do anything that has an eternity attached to it. The Bismarck sunk, the Titanic sunk, and they said none of those things could happen to those things. Even God himself could not sink the Titanic. That was kind of the Bismarck. That was kind of a phrase that they said. Is God able to sink it? He is. Is he able to have everybody go down to the bottom of the sea that's in that boat, that ship? He is. Is God able to bring them back to life and bring everybody back out of there without anything by man? He is. But if you think, my friend, that you can declare something natural, supernaturally, we've got a problem coming. Amen? And so the eternal flame has gone out at least two times. And so has the eternal flame of God gone out a long time ago at Oak Grove. I was pastoring there, and I got a book in the mail. And the book in the mail talked about the fire of hell. And it talked about a good God, a loving God, a merciful God, and God who is loving, merciful, and kind would never send anybody to an everlasting hell. And so I read a little bit of the book as I went through it, and it was winter time. And as I read a little bit, try to find the truth of the lie out in it and all the falsehoods and the things in it, I would tear it out and I'd put it in my fireplace. That's kind of poetic, isn't it? I think it is. That they were talking about hell not being eternal, it not lasting, and I couldn't think of a better thing to happen to that after I studied, got what knowledge I wanted of it, than to cast it into the fire. And so, yeah, amen. They wanted to just go ahead and somehow or another root out all of the bad things as far as judgment goes, and then say anybody can go to heaven. But not just anybody can go. You've got to be saved. As I preach this morning, amen. First thing you got to know is that your heart and your life is right with God. Look with me in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, verse 40. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, and verse 40. And then he said, "And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye have done it unto the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me." Verse 41. Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, depart from me, ye cursed, into everlasting fire, prepared for the devil and his angels. God is going to cast the devil and his angels eventually at a perfect and an accepted perfect time into everlasting fire. And then we go on from there. And for ye, I was hungry, ye gave me no meat, I was thirsty, ye gave me no drink, I was a stranger, ye took me not in clothed, and ye naked, and ye clothed me not, sick and in prison, ye visited me not. Then shall they also answer him, saying, Lord, when saw we thee an hungered, or thirst, or a stranger, or naked, or sick, or in prison, and did not minister unto thee? Then shall he answer them, saying, Verily I say unto you, inasmuch as ye did it not to one of the least of thee, ye did it not to me. And these shall go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into life eternal. Amen. And so I want us to make sure that we understand that eternal, the flame is eternal. President Kennedy's flame at his graveside is not eternal. Amen. It is in fact temporary. It is not lasting as it's going to be in another 400 or 500 years if time goes on that long. And we study JFK, our 10th generation, 12th generation from now, study JFK, they'll have to wonder by the history books who that person was, because he's going to be forgotten. But God's eternal, everlasting flame, it's still going to be burning. Never how long the time goes. Now, in the book of Revelation, we're going to read there real quickly. All right, Revelation chapter 19. I want you to turn with me and look at the Word of God in this. Revelation chapter 19. And while you're turning, there are 25 verses that mention fire in the book of Revelation, the entire book of Revelation. Most of them deal with judgment. Not all of them, but most of them deal with judgment. One or two of them also deal with purity, purification, which is done by fire. And that's what the judgment of God's eternal damnation for the lost is, for the devil and his angels. It talks about judgment and cleansing. Those that go to hell are never going to get cleansed. Why? Because what is going to cleanse sin? Blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. So there are 25 verses in the book of Revelation that deal with fire. Most of them judgment. Revelation chapter 19 and verse 20. And the beast was taken with him and the false prophet that brought miracles before him, that which with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into the lake of fire, burning with brimstone. Chapter 20 and verse 10. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Verse 14. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Chapter 20 and verse 15. Whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. You can mark this down. You can write it down. You can put it on your calendar. And you can remember this. Amen. The flames of this world are going to go out one day. God is going to burn this earth with a flame, with a fervent heat. Is going to melt this earth. But even that's going to go out. But the fire of God's judgment is eternal. Nobody deserves to go there, do they? Only those that refuse the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen. God's entrance ticket to heaven is the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And you know, I don't want to ever get in a message where I make it so hard to understand the pure, simple truth is that Jesus can save a 4 or 5 or 6 or 7-year-old child, an 8-year-old or 9-year-old child, or he can save somebody that's well up in years. Jesus is able to save any of them. When they come to the age of accountability and God begins to knock on their heart's door and they understand that they need a Savior, whether they understand everything in this book or not, That's the time for them to come. Amen. And God is able to save them if they'll confess Him and they'll pray to Him and ask Him for forgiveness of sin, to come into their heart life and become a Christian and live for Him. Live for Jesus. Amen. But the truth is that the fire is going to go on and on and on for those that leave this world without Jesus Christ. Look in the book of Jude, verse 7. Verse 3 said, "Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the truth which was once delivered unto the saints. For there are certain men crept in unawares, who were of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness, and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. I will therefore put you in remembrance." That's what I'm doing tonight. Amen. "Though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not." Saved all of them that came out of Egypt. Then there's some that believed not and were destroyed during the process of the wandering. Verse 6. "And the angels which kept not their first estate." What was the angels' first estate? Holiness, righteousness. And that they would be the ministering spirits of God to those that would be the what? Heirs of salvation. Then he goes on to say, "The angels kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation. He hath preserved an everlasting chains under darkness, under the judgment of the great God." Verse 7. "Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities round about them in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication, homosexuality, and going after strange flesh, men to men, women to women, are set forth an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire." One fellow that, as I studied for this, and was looking, it wasn't a commentary, I don't have any old commentary, I had to do a little bit of searching. There's a verse that came on my mind, and there's one fellow that said that what he's talking about here is that you don't spend, your soul doesn't spend eternity in hell. And I thought, well, now that's an interesting concept in the Baptist church today. In fact, if you leave this world lost, your soul does spend eternity in hell. And look what he said, and this is a verse that he used. "Even as Sodom and Gomorrah and the city round about them, in like manner, giving themselves over to fornication." So the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah and those that were around that area are going after strange flesh, are set forth for what? An example. As God burnt Sodom and Gomorrah and cast them down in fire and brimstone, he said, for an example, suffering the vengeance of eternal fire. And so he said, is Sodom and Gomorrah burning forever and ever and ever? No, they're just natural places in this world. But what happened there? What happened in Sodom and Gomorrah? That's what he's talking about. Amen. The sin, the iniquity, the base sinfulness that they were involved in, homosexuality. That's those kinds of things that God said not going to enter into His heaven, not going to go. It's going to spend eternity. I love the homosexual. I don't know what homosexuals do. Amen. I love the drunkard. I don't love what the drunkard does. I can go down a long list, but you get my point. It's not the individual, the person that we need to hate. It's sin that's being accomplished to destroy their life. That's what we hate. Amen. That we're separate from those things. That we pray for people and we try to show them a right way, a holy way, a separated way. Amen. We're not hateful about it, but we try to show the love of God. But we show them the righteousness as we show them the love of God. We don't compromise with sin. Doesn't matter whether it's my child or your child, my grandson, my granddaughter, your granddaughter. It's all the same. As I said this morning, friend, I've got my and your and my children, your grandchildren, grandchildren. They all their souls stand in the balance, and I want them to know what's right and what's wrong. I want to have no question about it. Our people today say there's a little gray matter in some of these things where that you can, if the situation calls for it, tell a lie. You can, if the situation calls for it, you can murder. If the situation calls for it, you can commit adultery. You can do this, that, or the other, if the situation calls for it. My friend, it does not nowhere in the Bible say that that's good, it's true, or it's righteous, it's holy, it's just. But everywhere that you look, it calls it what? Sin. Amen. Calls it sin, calls what it is. And so we look, we find these things that the world wants to agree with and the world wants to go with, and yet we find out that those are not the things of God tonight, not the way that the Lord would have us to be. And so has the flame gone out? The question that I would put to you tonight is, no, God's flame hasn't gone out. Man's flame has a number of times. Well, the Bible considers our life and our living here sometimes as a candle. And that when the candle goes out, when the light goes out, our life is gone. Amen. But one of these days, we're going to stand before God. We're going to give an account to our lives. And we're going to have to answer to God for the things in our life. We'll not be burned up when you go to hell. And just for a little while, you turn into ashes to be trampled under the foot of men. Another verse that I was reading. No, that's not the way this is going to happen. When you leave this life and your soul is bound for hell, it's going to last eternally. Don't nobody go to hell. Amen. Make up your mind, I'm not going. I'm going to give Jesus my heart, my life. I'm going to live for Him. And I'm going to let the world know whose side I'm on. Amen. Would you stand? Let's go to the Lord. And it's all invitation.